Genesis 20, we looked at this morning. What does this have to do with Ecclesiastes? Well, we saw this guy Abimelech, didn't we? Verse 2. This looks so easy. Abraham is journeying. He's a powerful man, but he's not as powerful as those who would do him harm. And that being the case, he made a deal with his wife, who was his half-sister. They had one common parent. He made a deal with his wife, say, you know what? In order to save our lives, yours and mine, you're going to be my sister. You're not going to be my wife here. And he's traveling. He's a man of business. He's a man of means. And he has things that other people want. And in this case, it's his wife. And Abraham said of Sarah's wife, verse 2, she is my sister, and Abimelech, king of Gerar, sent and took Sarah. That was easy, wasn't it? Yeah, what do? Plan weddings. Ask a father for a daughter's hand. Make sure we believe the same things. Make sure we love this other person, want to be with them. Abimelech didn't have those kind of problems, did he? He just went and he took Sarah. Well, why did we read this? Well, our sermon title this morning, Solomon's Wisdom Meets the Fear of the Lord. And what did Abraham recognize about Abimelech that made him so scared? And he was scared. He was in fear, no doubt about it. And Abraham said in verse 11, you know, Abimelech, dear Abimelech, we don't have time to look at him, but he's like, I'm innocent. He's innocent, all right. He's innocent in knowing what God would do to him. Because God appears to him and says, you're a dead man. Boy, talk about the fear of the Lord being the beginning of wisdom. Wow. Abimelech acts a whole lot differently. But Abraham says in verse 11, because I thought surely the fear of God is not in this place, and they will kill me on account of my wife. Question for you. Do you think Abraham just sort of came up with that on his own? Like, I don't know. These people might kill me. Never really heard of it happening before. No, Abraham knew what he was doing. He knew that this kind of thing had happened before. And he knew that a powerful man, if he had an attractive wife, could make her a widow just that quickly. He could do that stuff. What's to stop it? What is to stop this kind of power and lust and wickedness that Abimelech was involved in? And we have the answer there in verse 11. It is the fear of the Lord, and my friends, it's nothing less than that. It's not a new philosophy. It's not a new book. It is the fear of the Lord, and nothing less. Shall we turn then to Ecclesiastes chapter 4? Solomon's Wisdom Meets the Fear of the Lord. We're going to be looking at verses 9 through the end of the chapter. And then verses 1 through 7 in chapter 5. Two are better than one. This is Ecclesiastes chapter 4 and verse 9. Two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fail, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. Again, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him. A threefold cord is not quickly broken. Better is a poor and wise youth than an old and foolish king who will be admonished no more. For he comes out of prison to be king. And though he was born poor in his kingdom, I saw all the living who walk under the sun. They were with the second youth who stands in his place. There was no end of all the people over whom he was made king, yet those who come afterward will not rejoice in him. Surely this is also this is vanity and grasping for the wind. And then a big kind of a change, if you will, in Solomon's Solomon's approach, in his statements here, in his preaching. Walk prudently when you go to the house of God, and draw near to hear rather than to give the sacrifice of fools, for they do not know that they do evil. Do not be rash with your mouth, and let not your heart utter anything hastily before God, for God is in heaven, and you on earth. Therefore let your words be few, for a dream comes through much activity, and a fool's voice is known by his many words. When you make a vow to God, do not delay to pay it, for he has no pleasure in fools. Pay what you have vowed. Better not to vow than to vow and not pay. Do not let your mouth cause your flesh to sin, nor say before the messenger of God that it was an error. Why should God be angry at your excuse and destroy the work of your hands? For in the multitude of dreams and many words, there is also vanity, but fear God. What are we to do with Solomon this morning? He appears to be kind of all over the place, talking about two being better than one and a poor youth, and then he goes, when you go to the house of God. Well, this morning we're going to try to put this together. One of the challenges in teaching the book of Ecclesiastes, and this is for everyone who ever wants to teach, which is for pretty much everyone in here, right? You may be a teacher now. You may not stand up in front of folks, but you're still a teacher. You're a teacher to your family. You're a teacher to your neighbors. Perhaps you have a Bible study. Perhaps you're going to get together today with family. You're a teacher. If you're a young person, you might say, well, I'm not a teacher. I'm just a kid. I'm the one that needs to be taught. Well, you know what, kid? One of the reasons why we're teaching you and why your parents teach you and why we try to teach you here is because you're going to be a teacher someday too. You will teach. You don't even know how much you're teaching now. But one of the issues that we have to deal with when we try to teach is we have to, especially the Bible, we have to put the passages together. And to give an example, the book of Proverbs, you could say it has a proverb and then another proverb that doesn't really have to do with the first one sometimes. Sometimes they do. Sometimes they're connected. Other times it's just wise sayings that are out there. And you could almost, I don't say you can, you could almost take the last chapter of Proverbs and trade it for the first chapter. I say almost because the first chapter has to do with getting involved in sin. The last chapter is the virtuous woman. And I think the last chapter is built on the first 30 chapters because it shows what wisdom looks like. So you can't, it's not quite that easy. And all scripture is given by inspiration of God. And there's a reason why chapter 1, Proverbs begins the way it does and ends the way it does. But I'm going to tell you something. You can't do that with the book of Ecclesiastes. The book of Ecclesiastes has a definite beginning and a definite middle and a definite end. And so part of my job as a preacher, teacher, hopefully, and this is what I want you to get, is that when you preach or when you teach the Bible, you want to do your best to connect it. Anybody can come out and just say, well, okay, here's a verse that teaches this, and we just leave it alone. Because I would argue this morning, and this is just for you to think about and to consider as you teach, because you either teach right now or you will teach. That's just the way it is. But when it comes to the Bible, we want to tie it together. Because if we just take the scattergun approach to teaching the Bible and preaching it, we won't remember it as well. But when we can connect it, now your hearers will remember it a lot better, and they'll take the lessons more to heart, and they'll be able to meditate on them more. So this particular passage here really gave me a hard time, I have to tell you. Walk prudently, chapter 5 and verse 1, when you go to the house of God and draw near to hear rather than to give the sacrifice of fools, for they do not know that they do evil. Solomon has not talked yet about the house of God. Solomon has just pretty much given us four chapters of great frustrations, and suddenly now we're in the house of God. How did we get there? Well, we're going to do our best this morning to explain that to you. And again, that's one of the reasons why we have why we have a question and answer time, according to what I believe 1 Corinthians 14 actually teaches. Well, first of all, in verses 9 through 12, Solomon talks about the value of another. He actually doesn't say a friend. A lot of commentators will say this is how you value a friend, but it doesn't actually say that. He says two are better than one. Then he goes on to say in verses 13 through 16, he's talking about about the advantage of wisdom there. And then, shall we say, the fact that towards the end of it, he talks about the fact that nobody really cares that much after you're gone, how wise you were. Well, it sounds like that sort of kind of happened to him. And then we go into that passage of in verses 1 through 7 there, walk prudently when you go to the house of God and pay your vows. So what are we doing here? Well, to begin with, I believe that Solomon shifts. We have, I think, a tremendous shift of emphasis with Solomon here. And he's going, I think, in a different direction. And I actually think that he goes in that, he shifts in that direction in verse 9. I think this is a critical point in the book. I think he's been going there before. He's been steering. He's not like a Dow Jones Industrial Average chart, you know, down and, you know, just jerks all around. I think he's more steering us as we think. We're more steering, shall we say, a ship, if you will, that takes a little bit of time to steer as he does this. You'll remember last week we saw that Solomon is completely frustrated because he has said that it's a good thing for a person to enjoy the fruit of his labor, a man to enjoy the fruit of his labor, and that is his heritage. And then we saw last week how those other people through oppression, taxation, and through envy attempt to separate a man from his heritage. And that's Solomon's frustration because he said it's a good thing. And, you know, it's funny. Solomon, when he uses the term better, when he's doing his comparison, it has to do with connecting a person with their work and the fruit of their work. Solomon is very concerned about that. Listen, nothing is better. This is from 2:24 of this book, Ecclesiastes. Nothing is better for a man than that he should eat and drink and that his soul should enjoy good in his labor. This also I saw was from the hand of God. Chapter 3, verse 12. I know that nothing is better for them than to rejoice and to do good in their lives. Chapter 3 and verse 22. So I perceive that nothing is better than that a man should rejoice in his own works, for that is his heritage. For who can bring him to see what will happen after him? And verse, chapter 4 and verse 6 that we saw last week, and verse 9, better a handful with quietness than both hands full with toil and grasping for the wind. And today, two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. And also better a poor and wise youth than an old and foolish king, which we looked at today as well, who will be admonished no more. And then in verse 5, better not to vow than to vow and to pay. Solomon is beginning to switch things around a bit. He's beginning to compare, and he's out of his funk, if you will, where everything just stinks. Nature doesn't change. My work doesn't change anything. That's what he said. I work and work and I give it to somebody else and just destroy everything. It's just all bad up to this point. Now I think he's shifting. Because when you're in complete depression, it's hard to compare anything is better than anything else. Now, thankfully, by God's grace, I've never been in a clinical depression. I've not experienced any of those. I don't know how many I've caused, but I don't think I've experienced any. I don't think I have. But from what I understand, when you're in this thing like Solomon was in, you can't talk in terms of better. And now he's beginning to talk, and he's using that term here a lot in the passage here. And I think that's our key that Solomon has changed. And I think the change is actually in verse 5. We begin to see it in chapter 4 and verse 9, or chapter 5, excuse me. But I think the actual change is in chapter 5. But let's look very quickly, shall we, at his statements here And he's talking about better here. Better, two are better than one. And in verse 13, better a poor and wise youth. But let's look quickly at two being better than one. We'll spend a little bit of time here because I want to get this across. And I want to use, for an example, David. David was the greatest king in terms of military conquest, in terms of security, than any other Israelite king by far. He's the one we go back to. Did David need anyone else? Or was it just David all alone? Did he maintain the kingdom, humanly speaking, through just being David? Let David be David, and all will be well. Turn with me, if you would, to 1 Samuel chapter 19. First Samuel 19, now Saul spoke to Jonathan his son, who was the heir, and to all his servants that they should kill David. But Jonathan, Saul's son, delighted greatly in David. So Jonathan told David, saying, my father Saul seeks to kill you, therefore please be on your guard until morning and stay in a secret place and hide. And I will go out and stand beside my father in the field where you are, and I will speak with my father about you. Then what I observe, I will tell you. We'll have time to discuss the entire passage. We won't. But remember, Saul's king and David isn't king at this point. If David, again, we don't have time for it, but if David does not cooperate here with Jonathan, and Jonathan is not a very good guy, a man of great character, who is interested in righteousness over power. Opposite of Abimelech. That's what Jonathan was. He wanted to do the right thing, whether it cost him or not. A really good guy. Not a perfect guy, but a very good guy. If Jonathan doesn't help David here, David is a dead man. The only thing standing between David and death is Jonathan. Well, that's a friend thing. We all can relate to that, right? Two are better than one? Yeah, David's dead. But I want to show you another friend, if you will, that's not a friend, that saved David's life and the life of many others. He wasn't a friend, but he was the one who helped David when he fell. Remember, he says that in Ecclesiastes, if he falls. You see, we always think of when you fall, the person helping you is a friend. Well, maybe they're not a friend. Let's see how much of a friend this guy was. 2 Samuel 12. David here, when we get to 2 Samuel 12, is a liar, deceiver, murderer, and adulterer. Can you imagine? Let's not give David any free passes here. Can you imagine how hard, what a deceiver you are to give him to give Uriah the Hittite a sealed envelope, and you trust him that much? You give him this sealed envelope, and he takes it to his commander, and his commander opens up the envelope and says, "Kill Uriah." What a deceptive, low-down, rotten thing to do, and David did it all. And he is in deep trouble. He doesn't know it. But God is going to punish him. 2 Samuel 12. Then the Lord sent Nathan to David, and he came to him and said to him, there were two men in one city, one rich and one poor. The rich man had exceedingly many flocks and herds. The poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb, which he had brought and nourished, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It ate of his own food and drank from his own cup, lay in his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. A traveler came to the rich man who refused to take from his own flock and from his own herd to prepare one for the wayfaring man who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the man who had come to him. So David's anger, his dear righteous indignation, was greatly aroused against the man, And he said to Nathan, as the Lord lives, the man who has done this shall surely die. And he shall restore fourfold for the lamb because he did this thing and because he had no pity. Whoa. Let's see. The guy just stole his neighbor's lamb. Gonna kill him for it? What tremendous bad perspective now by David. Let's see, David. You just murdered and cheated, lied, and were deceptive. And you're alive. But you're gonna kill a guy who stole a lamb. And on top of that, he's gonna restore fourfold. I guess he's gonna do that before they stone his lights out. And look what Nathan does. What a gutsy prophet. Talking to a murderer here. Say something like this to a murderer. Then Nathan said to David, you are the man. Thus says the Lord God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel, and I delivered you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your keeping, and gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if that had not been too little, I would have given you more, much more. Why have you despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? And we go on, and David thankfully acknowledges that he sinned greatly here. What do you think? What do you think happens to David and this kingdom if there's no Nathan the prophet at this point? Nothing less than total destruction, my friends. Nothing less than that. We would not know about the kingdom of Israel. It would have been over. But the thing is, Nathan really is a friend, isn't he? Isn't that what friends do? I would argue that with all his court and all the people he has around him that tell him what a great king he is, I would argue that at this point in his life, David had only one friend in the world. One. And that was Nathan. So even though the Ecclesiastes passage doesn't say that that it's a friend, it truly is a friend if we know how to define it. And this isn't the only time. Look, if you would, to 1 Kings 1. This is a critical time here, too, as well. David is dying. And if you know anything about the Old Testament, if you know anything about the transfer of power, really, in godless countries today, transfers of power are usually accompanied by blood, by dead people. King David was old, 1 Kings 1. Advanced his years. They put covers on him, but he could not get warm. Now, he's that old. Got a problem. We got a young man that wants to be king. His name is Adonijah. And he might know something about how to become king. He's no slouch. You remember Absalom? Absalom almost became king. He knew how to get elected. Happens sometimes, right? You know how to get elected, but then you don't know what to do once you're elected, right? The difference between getting elected and actually functioning once you're there. That's what Absalom's problem was. And Absalom has a brother named Adonijah. In fact, the end of verse 6. Well, let's read verse 6. And his father had not rebuked him at any time, saying, why have you done so? He was a spoiled brat. Dad wasn't going to step in and discipline here. Dad was off doing something else, maybe committing adultery and murdering people. Maybe that's a little hard to say that. But Dad wasn't paying attention. He was a very good-looking. His mother had born him after Absalom. So he's Absalom's brother. Absalom sure knew how to do these things. And he conferred with Joab, the son of Zeruiah, and with Abiathar the priest. And they followed and helped Adonijah. But Zadok the priest, Benaiah the son of Jehoiada, Nathan the prophet, key on that one, Nathan the prophet, and others didn't do this. They weren't with him. So we have a split happening immediately. David's still alive, and they're beginning already to fight over this. And Adonijah sacrificed sheep and oxen and fattened cattle by the stone of Zoelith, which is by in Regal. And he brought everybody, and it was a big coronation, big celebration service. But he did not, look who look who's not coming. He did not invite Nathan the prophet or some of these other men. So he knew what he was doing. He wasn't innocent in this. What's going to stop him? The good-looking guy is taken over. And he's got all the power people behind him. Joab? That's a power guy. Zadok the priest? Yeah. What's going to stop him? Look who's there. Look who's there to put a stop to this. So Nathan spoke to Bathsheba, the mother of Solomon, saying, "Have you not heard that Adonijah, the son of Haggith, has become king, and David, our Lord, does not know it? Come, please, let me now give you advice that you may save your own life and the life of your son Solomon." And we don't have time to read the entire passage there, but Nathan the prophet is the one who sees what's going on, and he saves the kingdom by getting the word to David. David is up there in years, his body's breaking down, but if you read the rest of the story, the entire kingdom hangs in the balance here, my friends. It is, we almost have another Absalom situation here. And who steps up? But Nathan again. Same guy. You see, by listening to Nathan tell him what he needed to hear, not what he wanted to hear, kings can always hear what they want to hear. That's easy. It's hard to hear what you need to hear. And by listening to Nathan before and saving his kingdom before, now Nathan is coming in and saving it again. What a great guy Nathan was. But David, this is my point here this morning, even though David was such a great king, he illustrates here what Solomon is saying, two are definitely better than one. Because on three occasions in David's life, if it would have been David alone, it would have truly been David alone, and we wouldn't be hearing about him today. Yeah, Nathan really was a friend. Two being better than one. Back to Ecclesiastes. We don't have time to look at this next passage. But this next passage, I think, if you want to study it more and understand it better, better a poor and wise youth than an old and foolish king who will be admonished no more. For he comes out of prison to be king. And I don't think that's talking about the king. I think that's talking about the poor youth. Although he was born poor in his kingdom. Now, I think the reference here that we can best understand this is definitely Joseph, right? Joseph comes out as very poor, right? He comes to Egypt as a slave, sold by his brothers to Ishmaelites, who really had no interest in Joseph. They were just out to make a buck. And his brothers pull him out of the pit and say, "Well, what do you give me for him? We'll sell him cheap. Just take him." Probably something like that. And that's where he is, he's a slave. And he becomes the ruler in Potiphar's house. Now, if you want to talk about a poor and wise youth versus an old and foolish king, later on we see the pharaohs who were extremely foolish, but in this particular case, Potiphar was pretty foolish. If you read through that passage, it says he didn't know anything was going on in his house. Joseph knew it all. And Joseph rose because of his wisdom. And that's what I believe he's saying here. The old and foolish king will eventually be displaced by the wise person. But even then, verse 16, there was no end of all the people over whom he was made king, yet those who came after will not rejoice in him. Surely this is vanity and grasping for the wind. And Solomon here, complaining again just a little bit, here's a wise person and no one remembers him. Well, here as he steers his ship to get us to think properly, he begins, I think, in verse 1 of chapter 5. And just very, very quickly, he talks about walking prudently when you go to the house of God and keeping your mouth shut. That's really what he's talking about here. Look in verse 3. For a dream comes through much activity, and a fool's voice is known by his many words. What does that mean? We kind of get verses 2 and 3. Don't be rash with your mouth. Don't let your heart utter anything hastily before God. Watch what you say in terms of vows before God. Jephthah would appreciate this. Remember Jephthah? in the book of Judges. He vowed that if God gave him victory, he'd give as an offering to God whatever came out to him and his first, and his daughter came out first, his only daughter, his only child. I'm sure he was thinking, I wish I wouldn't have been so rash. And what does this mean? A dream comes through much activity, and a fool's voice is known by his many words. And then he goes back, when you make a vow to God, delay not to pay it. He has no pleasure in fools. Better not to vow than to vow and pay. And it appears as if Solomon here is talking about those who, shall we say, make a show of service to God. You know, like I made a vow. Thankfully, I've never really, I've heard that said in private conversations. I've never heard that said publicly. I made this great big vow. I've never heard that, thankfully. Because it's not the vow that you made. It's not about who knows it. It's only about one person who knows it, and that's God. And he's saying you better keep it. So he's saying you better be cautious in making vows, and you better be cautious in keeping them as well. But what does this have to do with his theme here? Well, verse 6, do not let your mouth cause your flesh to sin. Just stop there for a minute. Do not let your mouth cause your flesh to sin. How does that work? How does your mouth cause you to sin with your flesh? Let's keep reading. Nor say before the messenger of God that it was an error. Why should God be angry at your excuse and destroy the work of your hands? You see, what can happen and what often did happen here, and we see in the Old Testament vows were often made to God. Not sure exactly what that means to us here in this era. Haven't studied it enough. But see, you kind of get the best of both worlds. You get to make this big vow in front of everybody, and everybody says, wow, what a guy, right? And then you don't keep it. And so you kind of get the best of both worlds. Everybody says, wow, what a guy. And then just quietly behind the scenes, you don't keep it. And that's the sin, I believe, that he's talking about here. The sin that he's talking about here is the sin of vowing a vow and not keeping it. But what is it doing here in this passage? I think our key is in verse 7. For in the multitude of dreams and many words, there is also vanity, but fear God. And now Solomon has turned, I believe, the ship completely around. And this is the key, these passage here, and I think this verse 7 is also verse 9 of chapter 4 is the beginning of the key, and chapter 5, verse 7 is, shall we say, the end of it, bookends, if you will. But fear God. That looks like it almost doesn't belong in here, but if you see the entire book, it does belong there. Because Solomon's answer to all the vanity, that he's loved that word up until now, use it again and again. And his answer is right here. But fear God. Now, Solomon has used comparisons up to here. He's shown frustration. He's talked about his observations. This is the first time in the book, right here, that he's told us what to do. You know, to a postmodern person, the book is kind of okay up to this point. It's just been Solomon's observations and his thoughts. You know, up to this point, can we say that Solomon has been sharing? You know we're allowed to share, right? No more sharing. Fear God. Do you understand? Do you and I understand this day that the answer to all of Solomon's philosophical problems is right here. Fear God. Listen. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all those who do his commandments. His praise endures forever. Psalm 111:10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. But fools despise wisdom and instruction. And David was this close to being a fool. But he listened to wisdom when Nathan came to him and saved a lot of problems. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride and arrogance of the evil way, and the perverse mouth I hate, Proverbs 8:13. Proverbs 9:10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Do we understand, no matter how many degrees behind our name, or how many spelling bees we win, or science projects we get a blue ribbon for, that if we don't have the fear of the Lord, we'll probably do more harm with our knowledge than good? You see, this is why education, proper education, is so important. Because if our children grow up with the fear of the Lord, they're going to find out what they need to know eventually. Oh, man, you know, that's not to say that sending your children to some school or whatever is not a good thing if that's the way they have a bent to do it, but let's get first things first here. Let's understand the fear of the Lord is the beginning of everything good. And it's the end of Solomon's nonsense, because up till now, I would say pretty much up to verse 8 of chapter 4, is not all nonsense, but it really is all frustration. And again, we don't need a new book, a new philosophy, a new religion. We need the fear of the Lord. So as we wrap up this morning, my friends, do we value the fear of the Lord? Or again, is this passage and that idea just kind of some far-off concept that we've talked about all morning this morning? It had best not be. It looks like David had a moment when he feared the Lord more than anything else when Nathan came to him. I want to tell you something. When Nathan comes and talks to him like that, David doesn't change his attitude and his view, and he doesn't repent because he fears Nathan. He does that because he fears the Lord at that moment, and he realizes it. We all have hopes and dreams. And we didn't even talk about the dream there. And if you want to ask questions about that, we can. Verses 3 and 7. We all have hopes and things we want to do. Make our mark, be significant, and so forth. But the futility that Solomon talks about, futility and frustration, can only be turned around by a fear of the Lord. That's it. Close with this illustration. I might have given it before. Sometimes I give an illustration. I can't remember where it was and to whom it was. But a few years ago, you all remember the Occupy Wall Street movement, or whatever it was. And like all movements, it appears to have moved on. I'm not sure. Very quickly, I had a chance, I think Ryan, you were there with me, to visit Occupy Lancaster. Lancaster had its own Occupy movement. I visited there. And I got a chance to talk to a few of the folks there, and I asked to speak to sort of the head honcho there, and I did. And I remember asking him, how do you know what you're doing is any good? He said, well, we're not greedy. We're against the greedy Wall Street bankers, blah, 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 blah. I said, well, what's your standard? They're bad, you're good. What's your standard? Well, he couldn't tell me what his standard was. So I asked him, I believe we have this on tape, actually. We do. So I asked him. I said, well, then how do you know you're not the bad guy and they're the good guys? If you have no standard, how do you know? You know what he said? We don't. There you are in the middle of winter with your guitars and hay bales and little tents, braving it out to stand up against greed, and you don't even know if you're doing more harm than good. I believe Solomon is telling us here that if we don't fear God, no matter what kind of resources we have, what kind of skills, whatever, that if we don't fear God, we will wind up doing more harm than good with our lives. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Let's not ever forget that. And when we're frustrated with the next generation, and they're not learning what we want them to learn, and they're not coming along according to their grade level, let's ask, are we teaching them the fear of the Lord? Because we better get that one down. If we're going to teach anything, we better teach that one. Shall we pray? Lord, give us your fear. May it not be some concept far, far away, but may we literally be scared to disobey you. May that be true of us, as David was, thankfully. And thank you for that example. Even though he'd been done all those things, when you spoke, he listened. May that be us. May we understand the fear of the Lord. May we find the knowledge of God. May we be concerned about that and have that be something in our lives that consumes us. We pray it in Christ's name. Amen.